Author's note. The accounts of battles and the historical background of Across Five Aprils are drawn from research in many books, periodicals, and other sources of information. As to the story of the Creightons, there is hardly a page in this book on which a situation has not been suggested by family letters and records and by the stories told by my grandfather. He was a boy of 9 at the beginning of the Civil War, and by the time his grandchildren knew him, most of his days were spent in reliving the war years, in which the great struggles sharply touched him and every member of his family. He was a good storyteller, and he gave his listeners a wealth of detail that enabled us to share with him the anxiety and sorrow of the times, as well as the moments of happiness in a closely knit family. It would indeed be good to have been able to ask the many questions that came to mind during the days of research and writing. It would be better still to be able to thank my grandfather for the memories he shared with us. This book is dedicated to his great-grandchildren, but the story is his. Irene Hunt.
Audio Bookshelf presents Across Five Aprils by Irene Hunt. Read by Terry Bregy. Chapter 1. Ellen Creighton and her 9-year-old son Jethro were planting potatoes in the half-acre just south of their cabin that morning in mid-April 1861. They were out in the field as soon as breakfast was over, and southern Illinois at that hour was pink with sunrise and swelling redbud and clusters of bloom over the apple orchard across the road. Jethro walked on the warm clods of plowed earth and felt them crumble beneath his feet as he helped his mother carry the tub of potato cuttings they had prepared the night before.
"It's damp fur down and warm on top,"
he remarked, poking a brown hand deep into the soil.
"Once we get these planted and a soft rain comes, we'll have a crop to make people up north call us Egypt for sure."
He filled a burlap pouch with the potato cuttings and hoisted it expertly to his thin shoulder, where a batch of new freckles was just beginning to appear. The world seemed a good place to him that morning, and he felt ready to stride down the length of the field with a firm step and a joke on his lips.
"Do you reckon we'll be through by the time ham and cornbread is ready for dinner, Ms. Creighton?"
he asked, grinning. He called her Ms. Creighton sometimes, as his older brothers did when they teased her. It was just a step from the too bold joke of addressing her by her given name. His mother smiled back at him, acknowledging his mood, but she shook her head at his words.
"Your hopes is making a fool of your reason, Jeth. We're lucky if these taters is bedded by noon tomorrow."
She made short, quick cuts with her hoe in the mellow soil and waited until Jethro placed a cutting eye upward in the spot hollowed out for it, after which she raked a covering of soil over it and moved down the long furrow. She was a small, spare woman with large, dark eyes and skin as brown and dry as leather. She had been a pretty girl back in the 1830s when she married Matthew Creighton, but prettiness was short-lived among country women of her time. She didn't think much about it any more, except now and then when Jenny's 14-year-old radiance was especially compelling. Even if she had been concerned, there were reverberations of Calvinism strong within her, which would have protested vigorously against the vanity of regret for a passing beauty. She had borne 12 children, 4 of whom were dead, perhaps 5, for the oldest son she had not heard from since he left for the gold fields of California 12 years before. She had lived through sickness, poverty, and danger for over 30 years. The sight of a pretty face might bring a tired smile to her lips, but it was a thing of little value in Ellen's world. Jethro was her youngest child, born in the year of 52, a year in which 3 of her children died within 1 week of the dreaded disease they called child's paralysis, a disease which struck the country that year, people said, like the soldiers of Herod. Ellen knew that she favored her youngest son, that she overlooked shortcomings in Jethro for which her older children had been punished. It was a weakness of her advancing years, she supposed. But this was the son who had been spared that summer when children all around were dying of the agonizing sickness. It looked as if, somehow, destiny had marked him. One didn't talk about such things. The world, she knew, was impatient with women who value their own children too highly. Ellen kept her silence, but she saw signs of special talents in Jethro, and she watched over him with special tenderness. They worked together for an hour or more without speaking. Ellen was grave and absorbed in the anxious thoughts of that spring. Jethro was accustomed to adapting himself to the behaviors and moods of older people, and he found enough in the world about him to occupy his interest as he worked. A south breeze brought the scent of lilacs and sweet fennel to his nostrils and set all the frosty green leaves of a silver poplar tree to trembling. There was a column of wood smoke feathering up from the kitchen chimney, a sign that Jenny was already making preparations for a hearty noon meal. From the neighboring field across the creek, he could hear the shouted commands to the plow horses as Matt Creighton and his two older sons got on with the spring plowing. It was a fine morning. Many people around him were troubled, he knew, but that was part of the adult world, which he accepted as a matter of course. Adults were usually troubled. There were chinch bugs and grasshoppers, months of drought, elections, slavery, secession, talk of war. The adult world of trouble, though, was not real enough to dim the goodness of an April morning. At about 7 o'clock, a team and wagon pulled out of the barn lot, stopping for a minute before turning into the road, while the driver spoke to a girl who came running out of the kitchen door. Jethro chuckled. Shad's leaving for Newton now.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.